Can I even put into words what has happened today? I'm going to try in this video. The day started out by a simple request that I'd like to know what right spiritual practice is. That was my beginning for the day. Actually, it started out in bed saying, I have a continuity problem. And going over and grounding myself and saying, the only problem that I have is a continuity problem. Then I said, tell me what right spiritual practice is today. Then it started. And it occurred to me to use this following format to say, my depression problem, or depression, the depression problem has no value for me. The depression problem has no value for me. Only the continuity problem has value for me. The global problem has no value for me. Only the continuity problem has value for me. I simply began to go over the safety problem. The safety problem has no value for me. There's no value there at all. Only the continuity problem has value. The security problem has absolutely no value. Only the continuity problem has value. So, went over each, many different problems that we have in the world, and I say, it has no value, Only the continuity problem has value. Only the vision of oneness has value. And this produced a tremendous momentum. And it's, I could feel it. It was like, wow, a huge boost suddenly. Is to shift value of problems. And what I saw was the door of freedom opening up. And I said, oh my gosh. I can see how to be free, how to drop all these problems in the world. It's simple, simple, simple. It's as simple as you're valuing. That's it. We literally have these problems because we value them. That is why we have them. And by deciding that you no longer value these problems, that's how you get rid of them. You can say, I no longer see any value in this sickness. I no longer see value in sickness. The sickness problem has no value for me. Only the continuity problem has value for me. Only the continuity problem has value for me. Transfer all your valuing of problems that we've had in the world over to the continuity problem and say, that's the only place, the only problem that has value for me. The only problem that has value for me. So, This was, again, an enormous boost. So that was the beginning of the day. And it seemed like, wow, that's just an incredible breakthrough, is to literally recognize that our problems come from our valuing of these problems. And now, why? Why do we value these problems? And here came another insight, another huge breakthrough. It's not quite that we're trying to impress God. That's what I've said before, but there's a further clarification. We're trying to impress upon God. We're trying to say to God, God, you have to be impressed by this. You have no choice. This is impressing you. The fact that we have all these problems impresses you because you don't have any. You've got more than you have. We have more. We have problems. That chainsaw there, saying, God, this is impressing you, period. So this depression, God, is impressing you. So that we value it, our problems, because we feel that these problems are the way to impress upon God that we're greater. That's the only reason we're valuing these problems, really. Plus, we have the continuity issue, which holds the problems with us. But our valuing comes from believing that this is what we can use these to impress upon God that we're prime creator, that we're greater. But when you recognize and realize this is impossible, it's total, just a whim, we no longer have to value these problems. And so we begin to to take away our valuing, exchange our valuing of all these problems, sickness, mortality, death, insecurity, vulnerability, accidents, loneliness, sadness, despair, confusion, fear, all sorts of mental problems of paranoia and terrible projections and all, and just trickery, deceit, treachery, stress, etc., etc. The stress problem has no value for me. The stress problem has no value for me. I see no value in the stress problem. I see value only in the continuity problem. That's what I was saying. I see there is no value in the stress problem. There's only value in the continuity problem. There is no value in the disease problem. There's only value in the continuity problem. So I began transferring value over to just the continuity problem, away from all the other problems. And it was just like, I could tell that this is getting incredibly effective now. Then, following that, again, I said, just right practice. What is right practice? After a little space of time. And then I began to say, what is enlightenment? I asked, what is enlightenment? And the answer came, instead of seeing things as primary and spaciousness as secondary, we see spaciousness is primary and things is secondary. That is actually enlightenment. It is that simple shift from things as primary to spaciousness as primary. That's all. That is all. Then came the further clarification that when we say spaciousness, we're not talking about space around things. That's part of thingness. Okay, part of thingness. We're not talking about the space around things. We're talking about the spaciousness that permeates all things, including space. We're talking about the pure presence. All right, the pure presence, the zero dimensionality, the pure abstraction, the pure absence of crystallization, total non-crystallization, non-form. In other words, so it's not the same as space. Space and spaciousness are we're talking about two completely different ideas here. Things have space around them, and then there's other things space around them. And we believe that the space stops at the thing, but space stops at the thing, but spaciousness doesn't. Spaciousness is equally everywhere. So this became clarified, the difference between what is enlightenment actually. What is enlightenment? Super simple. We simply shift from seeing things as primary to seeing spaciousness as primary and things as decorations, mirage-like crystallizations in spaciousness. But I was just getting warmed up, actually, for the day. This seemed like, a lot for one day. Later in the day, again asking what is right practice, and there was this dawning of God realization again. And I was sort of aware that everything is equally abiding in the spaciousness. Everything is equally abiding in the spaciousness. Let's see how to put this. We can talk about this. We can talk about this. Very, very important. The dawning came from just saying that enlightenment is seeing spaciousness as primary. And then from that, this dawning began, where I got this sense of everything is... Oh, okay, I remember what it was. Everything is totally safe and at home and happy. It first started out with everything is perfectly happy, equally happy, because it is, can never not be perfectly in this spaciousness. Everything is actually perfect happiness. This began to dawn upon me, that the nature of everything actually is bliss. Nature of everything actually is bliss. Oh, I know what it was. Okay, I'm trying to recollect. I've had so many breakthroughs today. I realized that everything has eternal life. Already has eternal life. Everyone's future. I was thinking about how can we be happy if our future isn't happy? That's what started it. I said, wow. You know, if you know your future and it's not happy, how can you be happy now? You can't. You cannot. And then suddenly I realized that since everything is eternally abiding in the spaciousness, is the spaciousness, the future cannot change for anything. Everyone's future is infinitely, eternally assured. And then I realized, oh my gosh, everything actually is totally happy. Nothing can be lost at all. Everything is right now, has this future, has this perfect future, forever. And this began to lift my spirits and mood. And this was like the dawning, sort of the dawning of God realization. Everything right at this moment, this very moment as it is, the future of everything is completely assured. In that it can never leave everywhereness. It can never leave. It is always going to be safe. That will always be safe. So, this began to build up, and says, wow, that's, you know, super amazing, wonderful. And I began to get this sense of happiness, and I saw how, hey, I said, wait a minute, everything, what is, to me, what is important, that everyone else is happy, that everything is happy. It's not me being happy, it's I want everything, the future of everything else to be happy. That's what's most important. How can I be happy if everything else is not happy? They have a terrible future. And I saw that the future of everything, without exception, it can never not have eternal life. Everything is eternal life right now. And so I said, oh my gosh, that makes me very happy. Very happy. Now it doesn't end here. This is momentum building up. Then I wondered, you know, what if I had met a teacher, a great teacher right now, who was, you know, perfectly enlightened teacher? How would that go? And I'd say, very simple, I'd ask him, what is right practice for me right now? Just tell me that, that's all I need to know. That's it. Super simple. Don't gonna ask any question about anything else. What is right spiritual practice? Just tell me. That's all I need to know. Then, later in the day, I began to be aware that since everything has this eternal life, We're all the same that way. Every last speck, without exception, has eternal being to it. At its very nature. I realize we all have this kinship. There's total kinship. But everything has this kinship. It's the kinship, this vast kinship of life. Eternal life. Everything at this very moment as it is, has eternal life. And we all share this exact same fact. And we have this then kinship with everything. It's not just me having a kinship with everything. It's everything having a kinship with everything. That is what I began to realize. It's not my enlightenment, it's the enlightenment of everything. Every leaf has total kinship with the entire universe. Every speck of dust has a total kinship with the entire universe. Everything, life, has a total kinship with all of life. All in all. So I said, okay, that's very, wow, that's great. It's a good day today. And finally, I realized that everything, since total presence everywhereness, omnipresence, doesn't have a center or a boundary at all, everything actually is perfectly centered in this eternal life. There's nothing closer or farther away. Total intrinsic centeredness. Location doesn't matter. Relativeness doesn't matter. It's totally non-relative. It's totally non-dual, totally non-relative. And this, I began to feel this. So it's sort of like this collective, this overall dawning, but it's, you know, I'm still working, I'm still driving, I'm still doing everything exactly the same. There's no, you know, big boom, kaboom or anything. It's a subtle thing. I'm just saying, hey, I see that, I notice that. This perspective is very nice. I like this perspective. It's sort of like a very subtle, slight subtle perspective change. But everything seems exactly the same. It doesn't seem like anything has changed at all, really. But it's kind of like my comfort zone is moving, moving, and now I feel comfortable with this notion of what I've explained to you. I say, yeah, of course, I'm comfortable with that. Now, how did I get to this? You know, it is. Well, I would say that all the spiritual practice we do eventually enables one to do this. What's most important is you just take it in stride. You don't break stride. I didn't break stride all day. I just say, okay, you know, just keep on going and just stay calm, mood of repentance. And just keep going. The most important thing is don't break stride. Just take it in stride. Expect, okay, that's like, okay, dawning of God realization, okay, great. Just notice it and say, that's very good, very good. Take it in stride. Don't stop to write a book about it. Don't stop to compose a symphony about it. Don't stop. Keep your stride going. So when you're able to take all this in stride, that's when it arises for you. So you don't get fixated. It's like the No, just let it dawn. Just let it dawn. Just let it dawn. Say, okay, here comes the dawn. Great. Just in time. Right on time. That's the key. And that is difficult, for sure. If you get these insights like I was getting today, any one of those is enough for someone to scream, Eureka, I just had this incredible breakthrough. And the world's got to hear about this. This is just so important. I got to tell the whole world about this. And okay, now what do I do? How do I organize my life around this? How do I, okay, I need to do this and this and this. And any one of those, But collectively, it's like, people would just be completely freaked out saying, oh my gosh, how can I present this to the world? This is like totally, universe changing information. This is just off any chart possible. But for me, it's just like, okay, that's fine. Good. We're getting there. We're getting close to the vision of oneness. Fine, that's where I want to be. Only the vision of oneness has value. Nothing else has any value. This isn't really, it's getting there. Moving the comfort zone is important, but only the vision of oneness has value. So, like I said, if I meet a teacher, I just say, what's the right spiritual practice? And then they tell me, I say, thank you very much. And just then get after the practice, that's all. That's how I feel. I don't care about anything else at this point. Because only the vision of oneness has value. I realize that. You don't have that, you don't have anything. We need that. It's super important to need that. So you don't stop. You just stay, keep it in stride. I'm certainly aware that these breakthroughs are monumental, of course. But again, at this point in my life, it just I don't care about, in fact, I've had breakthroughs, fine. But the goal has to be reached. So now if I was younger and thought I had a lot of time, I might be very impressed by these breakthroughs. I'd say, wow, I got to write a couple books on this one. Spend maybe 10 years on it or something. But by not breaking stride, the next one comes, and the next one comes, and the next insight, and the next insight. And I said, wow, okay, that's great. Keep it going. Keep the ball rolling. So it's a matter of just keeping the ball rolling, really. Keeping the ball rolling. And the benefit of great gurus is that they're completely unimpressed by any of these breakthroughs. It's like, guru, look at today. I just had all these breakthroughs. I mean, I realized the intrinsic centeredness of everything. I realized the total kinship of everything and the connectivity of this kinship of everything connected with everything. I realized that. I realized how to do the practice. I realized what enlightenment is. I realized the right practice of transferring value. I understood how that works, how effective it is. The guru would say, okay, that's good. Now, keep going. Don't break stride. Now, that's all. Make a video of it. It's fine. Make a video. Share it. Completely unimpressed, by it. Because again, we're not trying to impress God with anything. We're trying to get the vision of oneness, which reminds us of reality. So these are like just, tinges, little tinges of dawn, kind of. I'm noticing, I'm looking over there and saying, wow, there's a nice, actually we're having a nice sunset right now, but this is a dawning. And then tomorrow's another day. You have to go further tomorrow. So you can't break stride. You got to keep your momentum going. But it's very welcome to see that I was able to get back this dawning, which I had several days ago and hadn't had since. I was able to get back to it. And even have a sort of more profound comfort zone with it. Kind of be more observant and say, okay, what leads to that? What is it that leads to that? And tomorrow will be another challenge, and who knows how that'll go? Don't know. But looking at it objectively, you know, it's a constellation of breakthroughs that are very, very profound, actually. Everything has an optimal future, a perfect future. Everything has a perfect future. And when you start to get that sense, more than conceptually, you see like the happiness, is you realize that everything is happiness, actually. The intrinsic nature of everything is happiness, perfect happiness, bliss, everything is bliss. Don't jump right into it. I didn't jump into it. I'm just kind of recognizing, noticing that fits. It all fits. Absolutely. Everything is perfect bliss right now. Right now. And everything is self-released as this bliss right now. That's how we can view it. That's how we view it. It's the intermediate step. Everything is self-released as that perfect future, that eternal life. We're already home. Everywhere is home. Everywhere is home. Everything is already home. Everything is dwelling in this home perfectly and always will be. Nothing has ever left. Nothing has ever left home. There is no leaving of home. And you just recognize, all it is recognizing that everything as it is dwelling in paradise, is dwelling in God. Everything is dwelling in God right now. It's always been that way. So, the key is you see this and just you observe and say, okay, stay in the mood of repentance. Don't react too much one way or the other. Just continue your regular life, just the you know, whatever is going on. Don't avoid getting too distracted from it. You know, don't jump into too many bad habits, not too severely. Just keep maybe moderate. Whatever you do, kind of be moderate so you don't go off the deep end in any way. Still be humble, be sober, be serious. See, I have a vast, 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 intense, extremely intense continuity problem, which is true, absolutely true. And that keeps you centered. That keeps you centered. So you say, well, yeah, these insights are great, but I have an extremely intense, totally vast continuity problem. So I need the medicine for that is going to take me a while, for sure. I'm going to need very effective medicine for that. So I need to get that medicine going ASAP. And it's not going to, you know, it's going to take a while for that medicine to truly be effective. I got to get used to it. So you just, that's the mood. It's just so, okay, this is very good. All this is very good, nice milestones to pass, but I still have this completely vast continuity problem. I'm seeing how, you know, it's starting to dawn about how it's resolved, but it's just the beginning of the dawn. And so there's a lot to come. There's a lot to come. The sunrise is yet to come, and abiding in the light of day is yet to come. So we just stay humble, stay repentant, stay with right spiritual practice. It works. It absolutely works. Again, I always ask myself, well, if I met, you know, the top-notch, great teacher, all, you know, historically great, all-time great teacher, what would I ask? You know, how would that go? And I've always thought my whole life, you know, what's right? What's right? What do you do? What do you do? What do you do? And today it was just, no, just tell me what the right spiritual practice is for me right now. That's all I want to know. I don't care about anything else. Nothing else. So that's yeah, that's right. That is the right attitude to have. because I don't have time for anything that doesn't work anymore. Nope, none of us do. None of us have time for what doesn't work anymore. There's an intensely colorful sunset, but this is more important. What is right spiritual practice? We have to get clued into it. We have to get clued into it. And we have to actually do it. Because that's our trump card over all the madness that the world can spring upon itself. And that madness is you know, legendary, really. It's epic. The confusions the world can engage in are just extraordinary. So we have to have the technology, spiritual technology, to trump that, and we have it. We have it. This is the best thing that's ever come out of Silicon Valley, is the right spiritual technology to trump the material technology, actually. That's the best invention to ever come out of Silicon Valley, for sure. I just had to be here so I knew what I was up against, you know. I'm up against all the stuff that you know, is going on here. Which spreads over the whole world, the whole planet. And it says, hey, this is connectivity. You don't need anything else. This is connectivity. We can call somebody somewhere. Wow, you're connected. You're connected. Now, what we're talking about is the all is totally connected with the all in total eternal kinship right this instant, this moment, as it is. This is a fact without us doing anything to make it so, without us having to do anything to sustain it. We don't need to do anything at all to sustain reality, to sustain the total centeredness of everything in reality, the total kinship of everything in reality, the total interconnectedness of everything in reality, the total oneness of reality. We don't need to do anything to establish it, and nothing to sustain it whatsoever. It's totally effortless. This fact is completely effortless. It does not depend on any effort whatsoever. It already is. Eternal life is the fact, is the present fact. This is eternal life. You are dwelling in eternal life right this instant. Everything is. So this is what we have to look forward to, is to begin to realize this. You know, that's great. That's great. Very hopeful day, for sure. Now, the timing of this is quite extraordinary because, and I've always said, for some reason that is, I can't even fathom, I'm always exactly on time. Entire life has been this way, exactly on time. So I tell people, don't worry, I will be on time. I said, I'm going to be there at 2 o'clock. I end up being there exactly, it says 2 o'clock in 0 seconds. To the second, usually, to the very second. I don't know why, but this today is the 13th of February 2014. This is the beginning of what I call the turnover times. And this is turnover times. It is a tremendous shuffling of the deck of values here in order to distract us from the fact that the problems of form have no value. They have no value whatsoever. Only the continuity problem has value. It is a massive distraction, where we say, oh my gosh, I was valuing that problem over there, but what I should have been done is valuing that problem over there, that form-based problem. That's what's going to happen. And if you don't realize that none of these problems have any value whatsoever to you, only the continuity problem has value, then you are certainly going to get caught up in the shuffling of the deck of the turnover times. It's all been planned very cleverly. And people will go nuts. They'll say, oh my gosh, you're valuing those problems? You're out. You're out. That's not valuable. We're valuing these problems. This is where your attention has to be. It's called the turnover times, the shuffling of the deck of values is what is going to happen now. That's why I've been so worried about these times and working so hard to get this, what is right spiritual practice, and be grounded in that, and then share it with the world, because otherwise we're going to be lost at sea, for sure. And you already are feeling this massive political correctness, this PC-ness that's been going on for a long time, of pushing different values, the pace of that has been picking up. At some point, it's going to reach quantum level, shift into some sort of quantum level of changing of values on this planet. And that will knock so many people away from truth, not realizing that the problems of form have no value whatsoever, none. Impermanence, the problem of impermanence has no value. Only the continuity problem has value. The global problems have no value. Only the continuity problem has value. Anxiety has no value. The anxiety problem has no value. For me, it has no value. Only the continuity problem has value for me. And you can make it personal if you want to. You can make it impersonal and make it personal. You make it specific, you can make it general. This is right practice. Sickness has no value for me. I see no value in it whatsoever. Sickness has no value. Sickness has no value for me. Only the continuity problem has value for me. And literally, that is setting sickness down for you. As you say this, you're setting those problems down. They have no more value for you. What has no value, you won't have. You don't have it. You won't have it. Gone. Gone with the wind. Because there's no value in it for you whatsoever. You perceive what you value. You experience what you value. And now you only value the continuity problem because the solution to that is the vision of oneness, which is remembrance of reality. And that is valuable. That, only that is valuable. And what is enlightenment, what is vision of oneness? It's seeing spaciousness as primary. Without a second. It is primary, and that's it. It is what it is. It is primary. That's the vision of oneness. And the vision of oneness, seeing that the spaciousness is primary, then it dawns that everything is eternal life already. There's nothing that needs to be done at all. and so all this begins dawning upon us. And eventually, the dawning gets stronger and stronger and stronger, and we begin to enter into a more and more blissful state of mind, actually. But I didn't enter into any blissful state of mind today. It was just very faint. But I could see, I can see, yeah, this is it. That's fine. Just in time. Now, this turnover time, I say from the 13th of February to the 13th of March, is a very crucial time where I would like to see everyone begin to be established in this dawn. Where we're already familiar with the dawning of bliss, of the vision of oneness. So that by the time we reach the 13th of March, our comfort zone has already moved. We've already, quote unquote, ascended, actually, because our comfort zone is within the dawning of the vision of oneness. It's already there. That essentially is ascension. It's not the totality of ascension, but it's kind of like when you're on a boat and the boat is going to go take sail, cruise somewhere. You haven't gone to all the wonderful places you're going to go, but you're going to go there because you're on the ship already. So we need to be on the ship for sure. on the cruise ship, which is the dawning of this vision of oneness. So already, like clockwork, on the 13th of February, the picture is suddenly, you know, comes into this tremendous focus, tremendous clarity. It's not just kinship with people, it's everything with everything. It's the all with the all. It's the totality. It's like God's residing within God, essentially. That's all there is God residing within God. It's eternal life residing within eternal life. It's like everything you see is one with you and with everything else forever. Now, that's home, isn't it? How comfortable can, you know, that's down home comfort, isn't it? Wow, that's a different type of comfort level. That's a state of like blessedness, a sacredness, like wow, everything is completely sacred. Not just to me, but to everything else too. I mean, the relationship between this plant and that tree over there is the same relationship that's going on everywhere. There's only one relationship. There's just one eternal kinship, just one relationship. That's it. Everything has that one relationship. It's all one relationship. There isn't anywhere else. Nothing can, there is nowhere else other than everywhere. So nothing can ever leave everywhere. Nothing is lost. Nothing can ever be lost from anything. There's only one life, and nothing is ever lost in that one life. So, and again, this makes no value, no sense to the ego, which values trying to impress upon God that it has something superior to reality. The ego says, I don't understand what you're talking about. Fine, doesn't matter. Don't explain it to the ego. Keep explaining it to yourself. Because the ego is just saying, I don't understand how this is going to impress upon God that we're greater than God. And I said, we're not trying to impress upon God that we're greater. So it's a moot point that you're raising, ego. It's no longer a relevant point at all. It's just completely irrelevant. Everything as it is right now is eternal life. And shares eternal life with everything else as it is right now. So is this a heavy realization? Oh, of course. So I'm just kind of, you know, trying to just edge up upon it, put your toe in the water kind of thing. That's all. Just all we have to do is put our toe in the water. And since it's already true for everything, there's you don't have to inform anything about it in particular at that level. There's not that motivation, like, oh my gosh, I need to tell them quickly before it stops being true. Did you know you're eternal life right now, but you know, maybe later you won't be? No, everything will always be that way. So do we have to tell everything right now? Not really. It's not going to change in the slightest bit. Ever. So, we exist as a universal being right now. Everything exists as a universal being right now. There's only a universal being. And again, just take it in stride, take it in stride, say, yeah. So we're starting to turn over times. And we may have a little grace period here to get established. I hope we do get established. Really get our comfort zone in the right place is all we need to do. Is to stay calm. Again, everything's okay. Everything's already eternal life. Can never be otherwise, so everything's fine. Everything's perfect, just as it is. Everything's perfect here. There's no reason to panic or think that you got to do so much for everybody, anything like that. At the same hand, you certainly don't want, on the other hand, you don't want to lose this realization. You don't want to throw it away. Otherwise, you won't recognize this and think you do have to save the world. Nobody has to save the world. Everything's already perfect, just as it is. We have a funny way of decorating that perfection in this world, for sure, because we're trying to forget this and trying to impress God that we have something different and better. But everything is perfect right now. Eternal life is eternal life right now. That's all there is. All there is this moment is eternal life. That's it. That's all there is. That's all there ever is. That's all there ever is. Eternal life is all there ever is. There's nothing else. And so we're kind of accustoming ourselves to this. I mean, it's like, wow, this is heavy stuff. That's good. That's good. Yeah. Eternal life is all there is. This is nothing else. There's nothing else. There is nothing else. And so we can practice like this, isn't it? It's fine to practice like this. That's called right spiritual practice. Just practice like that. And it does have effectiveness to it, no question about it. And don't try to look for results. Don't look for results. Just let them come. Just keep practicing. Keep practicing as best you can. And whatever results come, just let them come. That's all. Don't look for any specific results. That really causes problems. We have the ultimate goal, vision of oneness. But don't look for that result. Don't look for any results. Just do the best practice you can right at this moment. And I'm just showing that's what I'm trying to do. You know, trying to come up with better and better and better expressions of what's truly relevant. Eternal life is all there is. Eternal life is all there is, without a second. everything in this world already is eternal life, without a second. And everything already has this perfect kinship with everything else. There's only perfect kinship, only perfect relationship. The eternal with the eternal. That's the only relationship there is, the eternal with the eternal. God with God. So I realize that this is, you know, right in alignment with what the great teachers have told us. So I'm saying, yeah, this is good. It all makes sense. It's all kind of a constellation of rightness, of right-mindedness. I said the way to escape the times is extreme right-mindedness. I'd be very right about this. Right spiritual practice is the way to sidestep the problems that are coming. But you have to be very right about it. Very right spiritual practice. Not the wishy-washy stuff we've been fooling around with for so long. But the adamant stuff, that the eternal life is all there is. Without a second. There's nothing else. There's absolutely nothing else. There's never been anything else. Everything has always been eternal. Every last speck of dirt has always been eternal. Eternal life. And it doesn't get this through any relationship, locational, relative relationship with where it is in relationship to other specks of dirt and rocks and trees and whatever. No, absolutely not. It makes no difference what the location is of anything. No difference. Everything is intrinsically, perfectly at the very heart and center of eternal life. And we all have that perfect centeredness, and we recognize it in everything. We're always looking at the center. We're always looking at the center of the universe, of life, of eternal life. We're always looking. Wherever we look, we're looking at the center of it. It's all the center. There's only one huge center. It's just one. It's one center, without a second. So you may be saying like, well, yeah, I understand, I've heard this before, but there's no way I can get it. You know, it's too difficult. Well, that's how what I used to think too. I said, I don't understand this stuff. There's no way I'll ever understand it. But I understand it now. Now what happened was, I think it was November 4th. I can look back in the videos. I believe I woke up in the morning, and I said it before, and I went to take a shower. And suddenly, I just understood spaciousness. I said, wow, what? How come I didn't see that before? And it had to do, what did it have to do with? What happened was, I then looked up pure spaciousness, and I came across this great teacher, Longchenpa. And then I had a dream the previous night about something like that. It's on the video. But what it was I got some sort of transmission boost from some great teacher, is what happened. That was on November 4th, 2013. So it's been December, January, February, you know, 3 months, and going, you know, 3 months plus now. What's today? 13th? 3 months and 9 days? Maybe it's been around 100 days or something. But yeah, about around 100 days since then. November has 30 days. December is 31. And 31, 62, 92, and 9 on this day. So it's right about 101, 100, 101 days. You can look at it that way. Since then, the progress has been incredible. That I now am able to understand this type of practice, whereas before I couldn't. I didn't get it. I really didn't get it. I knew that I needed to get it, but I didn't get it. And then just one morning, it suddenly dawned upon me. This somehow, intuitively, I have some intuitive understanding of spaciousness where I didn't before. I don't know how, but again, it was some sort of helper transmission by this teacher. So don't give up, don't give up, don't give up. You don't know, you may wake up some morning and it suddenly dawns upon you. So, oh my gosh, I thought space stopped at objects. I thought spaciousness stopped at objects. It doesn't stop at objects. I also got a boost in Ramana Maharshi. He's talking about someone digging a hole in the ground and he said, where did the space come from in the ground? He said, it was already there. It's always been there. We think, you know, I said, that just struck me, and that gave me a boost too. I said, oh my gosh, I thought that spaciousness stopped at things. And I understood it doesn't stop with things. Where are things? They're in the spaciousness. They're part of the spaciousness. Things are part of the spaciousness. They're not separate from it. And that dawned upon me, so I got a boost there. So, and then I've gotten more boosts from my other teachers, Jesus and Sri Anandamayi Ma, that I understand what they were getting at. You know, the whole thing is just like, you get boosts at some point in time. So don't give up. You say, well, I just don't get it. Say, that's okay. It's okay that I don't get it. But it's gettable. It's gettable. I would say the most important thing is the mood of repentance. The better you are at that, the closer you're going to getting it for sure, because then you'll realize, hey, I can get this. I don't need to freak out if I get an insight and write a book about it or make a movie or tell the world or, you know, just like, oh my gosh, I'm really impressive. I had this amazing breakthrough. No, you just stay in the mood of repentance. Say, okay, no matter what happens, you stay in the mood of repentance. No matter what the insight is, you stay there. You make a commitment. You're going to stay in that mood of repentance, no matter what the insight is. I don't care if you know, the greatest teacher that we've ever seen walks up to you, you're still going to stay in the mood of repentance. Say, what's right spiritual practice? Please, that's all I want to know. And then and you get the right spiritual practice, and you still stay in the mood of repentance. That is the best way to make progress. So if you say, I don't get this, I don't get it, I don't get it, just say, well, I'm going to stay in the mood of repentance and keep practicing the mood of repentance, and just, again, say, I have a continuity problem. That center, say, I don't have a global problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a life problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a career problem, I have a continuity problem. There is no value in career problem. There's only value in continuity problem. There's no value in life problems. There's only value in the continuity problem. There's no value with form-based problems. There's only value with the continuity problem. Keep practicing that. You can do that. That will then get you ready for the boost that you need. And then you'll start having breakthroughs and stay in the mood of repentance. Keep practicing the mood of repentance. That is the most basic, important aspect of a spiritual path, is a mood of repentance. Say, God, I can't remember reality. I have this immense continuity problem. It's totally vast, and I realize that this has to be solved. Humbly asking for help in this, and I know it's going to take quite a bit of remembrance to remember reality, because I got no clue at this point. I got no clue. Just stay with that, stay with that, stay with that, stay with that, stay with that. Every single day, start with that. I got a vast, intensely vast continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. That is what's actually worked for me. That is what is working. And I see why it's working. Don't break stride. Just, you know, get to the point where I'm just staying in the continuity problem. Thank you very much. Okay. Thank you very much. Got the insight. Thank you very much. Still have this vast continuity problem. It's like you're anchored. So, after all these great insights today, great breakthroughs, I still have this vast continuity problem. But I also am seeing that nothing has any problem at all. But seeing that is part of resolving the continuity problem. There's absolutely no future problems or anything. Nothing has a problem. And the only problem we have is the continuity problem, and simply that we've forgotten that nothing has a problem. There is no problem. So we really have forgotten reality to an extreme extent. And the world is amplifying that constantly to an incredible extent. So, stay in the mood of repentance, in the continuity way of the continuity problem. Say, the stress problem has no value for me. You know, this morning I realized that. I just saw all these problems. I said, they don't have any value for me at all. There's no value to them anymore. Stress problems have value for me? No. Is trying to solve the stress problem have any value for me? Not none. Trying to solve the depression problem, any value? None. Trying to solve the anxiety problem? No value. No value. Only the continuity problem has value. So I don't need stress. I don't need depression. Does trying to solve the death problem have value? No. I don't need death. How about trying to solve the age problem? No. No value there. I don't need old age. Trying to solve the body problem. Does that have value for me? No. Don't even need a body. Then I realize that all I need is spirit. I don't even need form or body. Don't even need it. There's no value in form problems at all. Form-based problems have no value. Absolutely none. Working on form, trying to solve form problems have no value. The only problem I have is a continuity problem. Just try that. Keep trying that. And then it'll dawn upon you, hey, I'm not really stuck at all. Not really stuck at all. I've just been valuing, I don't have to value this stuff. I don't have to value the body or form at all. I don't have to value it. I don't have to solve any of the problems of form. There's no value there whatsoever. None. Because it doesn't remind me of reality in the slightest bit. Not in the slightest bit. So what value could there be to it? None. Unless I'm trying to impress something upon God, which is just sheer whim, which has no value to it either. So, now when these insights subside, what do? Just stay humble and say, I have a continuity problem. Yeah, it's the only problem I have, and go right back to the continuity issue. When these insights happen, you do feel like, wow, and you're just sort of like really enjoying this incredible breakthrough. Fine, just enjoy it. Don't cling to it or try to grab a hold of it. Just be with it. Just be with it as it is. And eventually it kind of subsides, and then you just say, okay, I have an intense continuity problem, and get right back to that. don't feel like, oh my gosh, I lost it. I don't feel it. I'm, oh, how did I let that go? Terrible. No, don't react. Remember, stay in the mood of repentance where you're not reacting to anything really, except the wow of the breakthrough that just arises naturally. But the other stuff, no reaction really. Okay, it's gone. Okay, it's gone. Just noticing that. But again, I don't have a noticing problem. I have a continuity problem. So it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. None of the problems matter. I only have a continuity problem. Have I forgotten it? It doesn't matter. I don't have a forgetfulness problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a memory problem. I have a continuity problem. And remembrance problems have no value. Solving remembrance problems have no value to me whatsoever, none. Only the continuity problem has value. And you just go right back to that, and it's like you're reinvesting everything that all the breakthroughs you've had, you're just reinvesting them constantly, and that creates a positive spiral. Okay, you're spiraling in a very positive way. You're on the path of remembrance when you do that. Just keep investing it all right back into the continuity. Only the continuity issue has value, which means only the vision of oneness has value, because that's the resolution to the continuity issue. So you're constantly reinvesting in the vision of oneness, instead of trying to invest in solving any of the problems of form. Solving the problems of form has no value. There's no value there at all. Because really, there's only eternal life already. The way that we're looking at form is again delusional forgetfulness. Why? Trying to impress upon God we're greater than God. That's why. So we're just making it up that this is impressive, that what we're seeing is impressive. We say, wow, you know, what we're seeing is impressive. No, what we're seeing is imagine hallucination, just a complete belief imposed that we're just making up. Just a made-up belief that we have created something different. That form is primary, you know, and spaciousness, space surrounds form, but it's not within form. It's form is, you know, somehow greater than everywhereness. It's just, this is all just make-believe. It's not actually the case at all. It's not actually the case right now at all. So we just have this delusion that this is so. Path of devotion is to say everything is God, and you know, be devoted to everyone as if it were God. That's one path to take. Actually, there's quite a different number, you know, of paths to take. Well, there may, you know, several major ones, kind of thing. Everything is God. Serving all, being of service, realizing that you're only serving yourself, I mean, because there's only one anyway. That's another kind of path that some relate to. This path of, like, clarity is another path that some relate to. This path uses the mind more, uses the intellect more, uses the mind, uses the ability to clarify and look and reason, uses reason more. Other ways don't do that. That's okay. Some use the emotion, feeling of devotion, service, and that sort of thing. Okay, so Now, there may be more insights tonight, possible. Maybe not, maybe not. Maybe this is enough for the day. I don't know. It'd be good if there's more, but usually at some point, the day sort of winds down a little bit. But I won't give up on the day. But dinner comes along, and then you get ready for bed, and then you get ready for tomorrow's another day, you're working. And so there are things that kind of, you know, get in the way a little bit. So, fine. But, you know, it is what it is. Just say it. I don't have a form problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a form problem. I have a continuity problem. Form problems have no value. Only a vision of oneness has value. Form problems don't have any value. I don't see any value in form problems. No value in form problems. No value in problems except the continuity problem. No value in problems. There is no value in problems. Only the continuity problem and the vision of oneness have value. We have problems because we value them. We see value. They're valuable to us. We think they're super valuable. That's why we have them. We have death because we think it's super valuable. We have this body because we think it's super valuable. We have this world because we think it's super valuable. We have all these troubles because we think they're super valuable. But we don't have to have any of them. We don't have to have form at all. Not as we're seeing it. Because actually the ultimate realization is that there is no form. There's never been form. It's only pure spaciousness. But that's beyond what we're trying to get to. We're seeing that spaciousness is primary, and that there is this perfect kinship and all this realization. But we still are looking at things, right? I mean, there's still form. In other words, form attribute is still being perceived. And that's the intermediate step. That's what we're getting to. So we don't need to try and make some great total abstraction. That's not what we're trying to get to, absolutely not. We're trying to experience the richness that we see of eternal life as it expresses from what we say is form. Including space. Space is part of form. Space is a form. Like ocean, water is a form. Ocean, sky, space, form, all that. That's ocean, that's form, too. There's static form and there's non-static form. There's dynamic form, non-dynamic form, and all that. So, the evening is still young, and it's now dark, and just continue on. Make haste slowly. We're in the turnover times. Just know that we're in the turnover times. Shuffling of values is going to now. We're in the lead up to this great shuffling of values. Certain things will happen to accelerate the shuffling of values. And can't get caught up in that tsunami. Cannot have to be at higher ground already. Okay, so. Continue. Stay centered in, I have a continuity problem. That's the only problem I have. All right, great, that's it.